Well, thank you all for being here. I'm Liz Magill, the Dean of the Law School, and I'm delighted you're all here for this panel on race and policing moving forward. As I think you know, the tragic deaths of Michael Brown and Eric Garner and the legal system's response to those deaths made us all urgently pay attention to the tragic role that race plays in our system. This is not a new revelation or a new fact, but I think it's fair to say that Ferguson and Staten Island made them more salient, more painful, and sparked a kind of discussion with a new intensity here at the law school and nationwide. Members of the law school and the Stanford community responded in all sorts of ways. Here at the law school, we saw profoundly powerful expressions of protest and of witness in the die-in that was organized by BALSA in December, and the very powerful, profoundly powerful Black Lives Matter event yesterday during the day and last evening. I can say that I've never been more inspired by the people around me, and especially our students, for their courage, their brilliance, and their passion. And I personally am confident we're going to make progress on these issues because of them. This event is one of several that people at the law school have organized to add to this conversation. It's intended to educate us, to make us think, to help us guide our future actions. Many people at the law school worked on this and other events. Some of them are here today. Diane Chin and Holly Parrish and Jory Steele of the Levin Center are back there, and Debbie Muckamal of the Criminal Justice Center were instrumental in pulling this and the other events together. I'll talk a little bit about a couple of other events that we're having this term and next term. But let me tell you about our panelists today first. I'm incredibly honored to introduce them. I can't think of a collective group of four people who have more wisdom and experience and knowledge about the issues they're about to talk about. I'll go in the order in which they're going to speak. Professor Ron Tyler joined us just a couple of years ago to run Stanford's Criminal Defense Clinic. He came to us after a distinguished 22-year career as a federal public defender in the Office of the Federal Public Defender in the Northern District of California. He's litigated appellate and trial criminal questions on every range of issue that you can think of. He was a distinguished trial lawyer and appellate lawyer, and for that reason and many others, as you'll be about to see, is in great demand as a teacher. He was a founding member of the Trial Advocacy Academy for the public defenders, and he's in constant demand around the country, throughout the country for his capacity to teach others. In just a couple of short years at the law school, he's become a central figure on our faculty, and based on personal conversations with many of you, he's become a hero to the students who he teaches who say they have never learned more, never learned from a wiser or more compassionate teacher. Professor David Sklansky will speak next, and we're all incredibly delighted to say that he joined us this fall from a school that is near here. David is one of the nation's leading experts on criminal procedure and the criminal justice system. He brings a wealth of experience and knowledge to the table, having served as a federal prosecutor early in his career and a special counsel to the Rampart Independent Review Panel, among other experiences in the world. He's written across an incredibly wide range of issues about the criminal justice system, the political science of policing, the interpretation and application of the Fourth Amendment, fairness and accuracy in criminal adjudication, and the role of race, gender, sexual orientation in law enforcement. He's an award-winning and indeed a life-changing teacher as well to his students. We are incredibly lucky to have with us for a couple of days here at Stanford Law School Professor Tracey Meares, who is the Walton Hale Hamilton Professor of Law at the Yale Law School. She's one of the Academy's leading researchers on policing policy from an empirical perspective. She's written landmark work on crime prevention, community capacity building, and police legitimacy. She's also been a national leader in translating the best of what we know from research to on-the-ground policy. She served on two National Research Council review committees. She served on the Department of Justice's Science Advisory Board. And under the auspices of the Department of Justice's National Institute for Building Community Trust in Justice, she and her colleague, Professor Tom Tyler, have launched an initiative to design intervention programs in five communities around the country to build public trust. Most recently, I think December 18th or something like that. She was appointed by President Obama to serve on a presidential task force aimed at strengthening community policing and trust among law enforcement and the communities that they serve. Finally, we are also incredibly lucky to have with us someone I think we still like to call one of our own, although he's gone to Washington, Director Ronald Davis. Attorney General Holder appointed Director Davis in 2013 to head the Community-Oriented Policing Services, or the COPS office, at the U.S. Department of Justice. This office is responsible for advancing community policing nationwide and supporting community policing activities nationwide. The reason I say we still like to believe he's one of our own is that before he went to the Department of Justice, he served as the chief of police in the city of East Palo Alto. He was responsible there for a significant drop in the homicide rate. Over a six-year period, homicides dropped over 50% on his watch. At the same time, police-community relations improved dramatically. As chief of police in East Palo Alto, Director Davis was a national leader among police chiefs in talking openly and vocally about the responsibility of police departments to help facilitate prisoner reentry. Under his leadership, East Palo Alto adopted a prisoner reentry program that has become a national model that other communities have copied. So as I promised, we have a wealth of knowledge and experience, and I'm going to turn it over to them very soon. I wanted to tell you just a few things that we're going to do both this term and next term at the law school. Next week, we have a presentation on grand juries, subtitle Arcane Institution or Sacred Cow. Professor Bob Weisberg and retired Judge Ladoris Cordell will speak at that event, which is next Monday. We have an event on January 28th, which is about litigating claims of police bias and excessive use of force. It's a workshop that will be led by Professor Norman Spaulding. Professor Sklansky is doing a reading group this term. I think the first meeting is in February. And we will do another reading and discussion group about the city of St. Louis, which is a case study led by Judy Rios, the former professor of architecture and urban design at Washington University and a PhD student at UC Berkeley, along with Professor Michelle Anderson. That's just some of the events we're planning. We have a website that will tell you about more of these events than I'll go into now. But please continue to come to subsequent events to examine these topics. So with that, I will do what I should do, which is to stop talking and turn this over to Professor Tyler.
Thank you, Dean Magill. It's customary for individuals at times like this to talk about what an honor it is to be present. And I'm going to say that, and I mean it sincerely. To have the opportunity to be present with you at this time, in this place, about these issues is an incredible privilege. And I hope that I'll do it justice. We've been asked to address three issues, really. What lessons should be drawn from the Michael Brown and Eric Garner killings and the nationwide protests that ensued? How can the distrust between police and communities of color best be addressed? And what roles do lawyers and law students play? In addressing these issues, I necessarily must do so through the lens of my own experiences, my own life. And I'm going to discuss these issues in three dimensions: in the personal, the professional, and the academic. I speak as an African-American man born into poverty to parents who migrated from the segregated South just prior to Brown versus the Board of Education. I was raised in the Rocky Mountain West, and then I was schooled at our nation's top institutions in Massachusetts and in California. So I think it's fair to say that I'm uniquely situated to bear the burdens and receive the benefits of America from the civil rights era to the present. As a former assistant federal public defender, as Dean Magill pointed out, I spent two decades in the criminal courts as a counselor, as an advocate, as a combatant for folks from impoverished communities in Northern California. And I now direct the Mills Legal Clinic's Criminal Defense Clinic, where along with lecturer Suzanne Luban and legal assistant Monique Cadena, I introduce our students to the local criminal justice systems that are faced by their clients. Together, we provide these students with the unparalleled opportunity to face the contradictions, the calamities and the conquests of that system. So how do these issues play out in all these areas? To be clear, these are my own views, my own perspectives. And when I think about the lessons that we draw from these killings and the nationwide reaction, I would be remiss to my parents, my grandparents, my ancestors, if I were not to say the following as clearly as possible, that one of the lessons that must be drawn from this, and I said this last night at the My Life Matters vigil, but it bears repeating, one of the lessons that has to be drawn from this, there's nothing new going on here. We're observing the sequela of age-old malignancy that lies deep within the heart of American society. These killings are among the latest examples of the barbaric dehumanization that fueled 250 years of slavery. Because they happened under the color of law, they're evidence of the stubbornly persistent institutionalized racism that pervades this and other countries around the world. These killings are emblematic of an enduring problem, and it's that recognition that has sent people into the streets of so many cities. Executions, extrajudicial or otherwise, are the worst excesses visited upon people of color and others in marginalized communities. However, it's also true that there are thousands of daily microaggressions that exact their own toll, and that also animate and energize the protests that we've seen. I could give you examples of my own, but instead, let me give you an example of someone I've known all my life, my twin brother, who was a top graduate from Morehouse College, and went from Morehouse to Harvard Law School, and went from Harvard Law School to Florida, where he was an attorney with the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, and then went into corporate law, first with Royal Caribbean Cruise Lines, and now in the corporate counsel's office of Masonite Corporation in Tampa, Florida. And when I told him I was going to be here talking about this, he said, oh, well, here's what comes to mind for me. One day recently, I was on my way to work on the Selman Expressway, ironically named after one of the few prominent African Americans in the Tampa community, one of the, I think, retired Tampa Bay Buccaneers. And he said, as I drove down this expressway in my late model luxury sedan, I noticed the police were behind me. Having violated no law, I continued on my way. Well, they stopped me. They detained me. They could find no reason. And the officer said to me, what time are you due to work? And I said, 8 o'clock. And the officer said, well, you're going to be late. And then the officer said, if I ever see you on this road again, I'm going to ticket you. Well, when my brother got home that night and he told his wife about this story, she said, just take another road. And he said, no, I won't. And a few days later, an undercover car pulled him over on the same expressway, different car, same officer. And the first thing the officer said is, what did I tell you last time I saw you? And he didn't say boy, but he may as well have. And my brother said, you said you'd give me a ticket. And he did. And he gave my brother a ticket for passing in a no-passing zone. Well, here's the problem. The Selman Expressway is one of the world's only reversible expressways. Every lane is a passing lane. And my brother retained counsel, and he took the case to court, and of course it was thrown out. But these things make a difference. These things do something to you. These things animate. These things send you into the street when there's a tipping point like Eric Garner and Michael Brown. We owe it to ourselves, then, when we think about the lessons to be drawn in the personal realm, to admit to ourselves and to each other that we're never finished growing as individuals or as a society, and that the same weaknesses and failings that were present at the founding of this nation remain present in all of us. We have to have the courage to recognize this in ourselves and in others. We have to speak out. We have to make room for viewpoints that go against the dominant paradigm. But on a broader level, As citizens, we have to be willing to hold our institutions accountable through individual action consistent with our own skills and resources, whether in the legislative, judicial, or executive areas, and also through collective action. As to the second question of how this distrust between the police and communities of color might be addressed, well, let me give you one, my first position in this regard, which is that I believe that the broken windows approach to policing has to end. This notion that the key to major crime reduction is a heightened focus on petty crime enforcement has been shown to be false. But worse still, it's led to a widespread regime of oppression against people all over the country. Consider the stop and frisk programs of New York. Consider how it was really a broken windows approach that led to the Eric Garner death after all. Consider the enormous numbers of minor cases that clog the nation's courts. Consider people who have described it as though they're living under martial law in their own country. In my own clinic, we've had several clients who've come talking about how the police station themselves as strategic choke points moving into their communities, waiting for the opportunity, for any opportunity, to pounce. Secondly, I think, just like my old hero Ronald Reagan once said, trust but verify. Trust but verify. Cameras on police cars, cameras on officers, tapes in all interrogations. An example from our clinic. 2 years ago, a young man was charged with resisting arrest and reckless driving. Briefly, the facts were these. An officer claimed that he saw a line of cars late one night exiting from a nightclub area. He heard a car revving its engine. His attention was directed to our client's car, having decided that that was the car. He stopped the car, ordered all of the individuals, Latinos, out of the car. He ordered them to sit on the curb. Our client asked why. He said, "You have 3 seconds." One, and then he threw our client to the ground. Two other officers joined him. They beat him with their fists, with batons, with a flashlight. The night ended with our client at Valley Medical Center charged with resisting arrest. And his case would have ended with conviction, but for the fact that there was a mobile video camera on that car. And after a discovery fight, our students obtained the video. They filed a lengthy motion to suppress, and the case was dismissed. Why wasn't our client celebrating? Because these things do something to you. So trust but verify. What role can lawyers and law students play? Well, law students, you're here. You do not need to view law school as merely the opportunity to slavishly memorize laws and adopt the viewpoint of the dominant legal paradigm. Instead, it's a time for preparation to engage yourself deeply in the issues of the day. And the pathway to that preparation is obvious, especially coming from a clinical law professor. Seek out opportunities to apply the laws that you're learning in service of ideals that matter to you. And of course, for lawyers and academics, well, we too are not merely the hand servants of the law or of the moneyed interests that the law traditionally protects. Charles Hamilton Houston, the first African-American editor of the Harvard Law Review, pioneering dean of the Howard University Law School, and the architect, many would say, of the strategy that led to Brown versus the Board of Education, once said that a lawyer is either a social engineer or a parasite on society. I don't really give in to digital thinking, and I have to tell you that I don't really subscribe to such a stark proclamation. However, it is instructive. Lawyers are fortunate enough, especially the lawyers and law students here assembled, to have credentials from schools of such a stature that they can make substantial contributions on these issues, even if only part-time or pro bono. Lecturer Danielle Jones yesterday at the vigil spoke about spheres of influence. Well, consider your sphere of influence and act within it. So in conclusion, let me say that the issues that we're discussing here today give all of us the opportunity to continue to grow and to contribute as individuals. Yesterday morning was the beginning of a new clinical quarter, which is my favorite time in the world. And it really is. And I have a remarkable group of students in the criminal defense clinic, diverse in gender, in race, in background, and in career aspirations, but all to a one, committed to this season of social justice. And my call to action to them is my call to action to all of us. Eric Erickson, the late departed developmental psychologist, said, "In this life, we prepare for things, for moments and events and situations. We worry about things. We think about injustices. We read what others have to say. And then all of a sudden, the issue is not whether we agree with someone else. The issue is not what we've read or heard or studied. The issue is, what have we become?" Well, in grappling with the issues before us together today, may we all become our better selves. Thank you.
I want to thank you all for coming today. It's really gratifying and encouraging to see so many people who are interested in hearing about, thinking about, and talking about these issues. I'm going to try to keep my remarks brief, partly because what I have to say I don't think is as important as what Professor Tyler had to say, partly because I'm more interested in what Professor Meares and Director Davis have to say than what I have to say, and partly because I want to leave a good amount of time after those of us on the panel have spoken for us to have a more genuine discussion, interchange with all of you. I've never been a police officer, and I'm not a member of a racial minority, but I am somebody who has spent pretty much my entire career thinking about law enforcement. And I've done that in part because I think that getting law enforcement right is the biggest and most important challenge of democratic self-government. I also believe that the problem of law enforcement in the United States is thoroughly and inextricably intertwined with the problem of race. I think Professor Tyler is right that you can't separate police racism from racism more broadly. But I also think that you can't really pull police racism apart from broader problems inside of policing. I don't think you can move forward on the problem of policing or on the problem of race without moving forward on the other. And I've spent a good part of my career trying to figure out how to move forward with both. So all of that has made it difficult recently not to have a kind of unpleasant sense of deja vu. Unarmed African Americans killed by the police, protests turning into riots, politicized funerals of police officers. It really feels like the clock has been turned back to the 1960s, and not in a good way. Watching the news over the past couple months, it's been easy to feel that nothing has changed. And if anything, I would say that impression has been reinforced by comments from people like Rudy Giuliani and Peter King, claiming that police racism is a thing of the past, that minority communities have no legitimate grievances about law enforcement. Those people were around in 1968 too, and they were wrong then, and they're wrong now. Still, I think it would be a mistake. I think it would be a tragic and damaging mistake to ignore the progress that we've made in policing over the last half century. We're not in the same place we were in the 1960s. And I think that to continue to move forward, we need a clear sense both of the critical challenges that remain and of the progress that we've already made, what's worked and what hasn't worked. Law enforcement in the United States has huge problems, and lots of those problems have to do with race. But in most of the United States, certainly in the major metropolitan areas, we're worlds away from the police departments we had in the 1960s. 50 years ago, American law enforcement was virtually all white, all male, uniformly homophobic, and homogeneously politically reactionary. Civilian oversight of police discipline was non-existent. The reigning orthodoxy among even the most progressive police executives was that departments should be managed top-down, like the military or like a 1950s-style corporation. And police departments, for the most part, didn't have a clue about how to do anything about crime. In most parts of the United States today, police departments are vastly more diverse than they were 50 years ago. They're more diverse racially, they're more diverse by gender, they're more diverse by sexual orientation, and they're more diverse by political leaning. Officers are much better educated. The range of opinion within police departments is much broader. Civilian oversight of police discipline has become commonplace, and there's a whole generation of police executives, exemplified in many ways by Ron Davis, whose careers have been shaped by a revolutionary set of ideas about policing that became conventional wisdom pretty much throughout the profession in the 1980s and 1990s, the set of ideas that came to be known as community policing. Partly as a result of those ideas, crime rates are down, although still too high. Rates of police violence are down, although still too high also. Now, civilian oversight of police discipline is a great thing. But the two really huge improvements in law enforcement over the last several decades, I think, are the other two that I mentioned, the diversification of police workforces and the community policing movement. Those two changes are related because the key idea of community policing is that the police should work in partnership with communities rather than apart from or in opposition to them. And it's hard for an insular, reactionary, homogeneous, unintegrated police force to work in partnership with a racially and culturally diverse community. Integration of police forces made community policing possible. Police departments know a lot more today than they did 50 years ago. They know a lot more about how to prevent crime. They know a lot more about how to recruit and retain minority officers. They know a lot more about how to work with communities. A lot of what we need to do going forward is to continue to capitalize on that knowledge. Because the truth is that there's been a loss of focus over the last decade. Community policing has sometimes, too often, been treated as a luxury in post-9/11, post-economic downturn America. And as for the diversification of police workforces, a lot of that was the result of affirmative action plans put into place in the 1970s in response to litigation. And the legal climate has grown much more hostile to affirmative action litigation. Many of these decrees have been allowed to expire prematurely. And many smaller departments, like, for example, in Ferguson, Missouri, remain untouched by affirmative action. So one lesson I take from Ferguson and Staten Island is to get back to some of what we know works, community policing and diversification of police workforces. But I also draw two other lessons, and I want to convince you to draw them too. So the first of these is, in a way, an extension of the basic idea of community policing, the idea that the best way to pursue public safety is through a partnership of the police with the community. I think that's the best way to pursue police reform, too. Just as it's important for the police to be open to criticism from the community, and for the police to work to shed their stereotypes and preconceptions about people they're sworn to protect, it's important for those of us outside of policing who want policing to get better to reach out to officers themselves and to invite them to be partners in the ongoing project of reform. And it's important for us to be wary of stereotypes and preconceptions about the police. There are bad, self-righteous police officers, just as there are bad, self-righteous doctors, bad, self-righteous lawyers. There are even some bad, self-righteous university professors. But there are hundreds of thousands of police officers in the United States who are smart, compassionate, and idealistic. They were drawn to their jobs because they want to serve their communities. They care deeply about the work they do and about the future of their profession. You want to tap into their energy, their knowledge, their idealism, partly because those are crazy things to throw away. And partly because it's hard to do anything about policing without the help of the police themselves. And partly because a big part of improving the police comes down to improving the quality of the average police officer. Just as it's important for police officers to resist insularity and defensiveness, it's important for the rest of us to remember that the job of a police officer, basically, is to go places the rest of us don't want to go and deal with people and situations the rest of us don't want to deal with. It's a hard job, and it's a stressful job. We take people in their early 20s. We give them a few weeks, maybe a couple months of training. We give them a gun. Most of them pray they'll never use, and we send them out into the streets. If we could make the worst 20% of them as good as the best 20% of them, We do more to improve the quality of policing in this country than virtually any simple change of policy or tactics could ever accomplish. So the point is that if we're going to improve policing, we need to keep in mind that there are human beings inside those uniforms, and we need to try to understand the pressures and expectations that they face. Okay, here's the last point I want to make. There's lots of work that remains to be done reforming the police, but the police shouldn't be the scapegoat for the entire criminal justice system. There are other actors here. There are other agencies that may be in even greater need of reform. So in particular, I would say, as a former prosecutor, we shouldn't be letting prosecutors off the hook. The largest demonstrations associated with the Michael Brown and Eric Garner cases didn't come after Michael Brown's death or Eric Garner's death. They came after decisions were made not to charge the officers responsible for those deaths. And those decisions were made behind closed doors by prosecutors. It was prosecutors who decided the officers should not be charged. It was prosecutors who decided to hide their decisions behind the cloak of the grand jury rather than own them and take responsibility for them. So I think it would be a mistake to see the Michael Brown and Eric Garner cases just as cases just about police brutality. They're cases about prosecutorial discretion and prosecutorial accountability, too. And if you really want to feel like you've taken a time machine back to 1968, don't look at police departments, look at prosecutors' offices. The path forward for reforming prosecutors' offices, unfortunately, isn't as clear as it is for police departments because we don't have past successes to learn from. We're writing here on a slate that's pretty much blank. That makes the task of reforming prosecutors' offices harder than the task of reforming police office departments, I think, but it doesn't make it less important.
Good afternoon. It looks like, since it turns out that my friend Ron here is an old friend of Stanford Law School, that I'm the stranger in the group. So I want to say hello to all of you, and like David, say how gratifying it is as a law professor to see your students, I'm going to call you my students for the moment, come out for an event like this. We did something like this at Yale. Shortly after the Garner grand jury decided not to turn in a true bill. And it was an amazing, moving, very sad, emotional experience. And I wondered how I would feel, actually, coming in here after experiencing that. It was very, very raw. Now it's been a few weeks, and you know, the president has decided to appoint a task force, and I have much more of an official position now, and I had to think about how I would feel about participating in an event like this. So it is really incredibly heartening for me to hear what Professor Tyler had to say. And, you know, David and I are old friends, so I kind of knew what he was going to say. And to see all of you. I don't want to say very much because, like David, I am really interested in having you all participate. That was really important to our students at Yale, and I assume that is something that you all are really eager to do here, too. So let me build on what our previous two speakers have said by throwing in a couple of different ideas. I first want to agree wholeheartedly with what Ron said about the salience of the issue. If one of the issues is what we're supposed to learn from the protests is, you know, is something new here, I think the answer, despite the changes that have been made, is no, there's a lot of the same happening. But what is true is that there's so much that is salient. And both Ron and David have made two of them very clear, you know, the ways in which the racialized structure of policing is persistent and creates certain problems. Yes, that's true. But I want to take a step back to point out something else, which is, you know, policing has its own issues, which I am actually going to spend the bulk of my 6 minutes, I'm going to give myself 6 minutes, talking about. In the context of institutionalized racism, yes, but that's operating and a particular class structure of this society that actually requires police to do many things that in a country with a more advanced social support system they wouldn't have to do. So to echo what David just said, we ask police to do to go places we don't want to go, to do things that we don't want to do, because they are available 365 days a year, 24 hours a day. And so they become effectively a social service agency in many ways for which they are not really trained and do tasks that they're not really trained to do. And they apply to those tasks a particular kind of behavioral modification approach that is not only not appropriate to the task, but I would submit not appropriate to good policing. So what is the shape of that problem? Well, the shape of that problem is the criminal justice system, not just police officers, but I think prosecutors too, are committed to an idea of procuring compliance through a commitment to formal deterrence. That is, an assumption that people are going to obey the law because they fear the consequences of failing to do so, because they have been primarily threatened with formal punishment. That is what's fueling broken windows in New York. The idea that you believe that the only way you can get people to comply is to put lots of law enforcers on corners, threaten people with stop and frisk, actually engage in stop and frisk, because what you're trying to do is change their perception of the likelihood of getting caught, right? But there could be a different view of how people decide to comply with the law, and that view is one that I have pursued along with my colleague Tom Tyler for the last decade or so. It's the social psychology of legitimacy. It's the idea that people obey the law not because they fear the consequences of failing to do so, but because either, well, I don't want to make it. I said I was going to give myself 4 minutes. Okay. So because they believe that a government and those in legal authority have the right to dictate to them proper behavior. And there's decades of research showing that what supports that, what causes people to confer legitimacy on those in legal authority, are some pretty simple things that you ought to treat people, you, the person in legal authority, with dignity and respect. Your decisions ought to reveal to them that you have made the decisions in ways that they perceive as fair, neutral, grounded in fact, that I have stopped you on the highway because you have in fact done something wrong and not because I hate you, which might be one way of interpreting your brother's experience. People often want to tell their side of the story in a particular encounter, even when it doesn't make a difference to the outcome. I'm sure many of you have experienced that. And finally, and I think the events that we've experienced recently give some credence to this. This one's the most nebulous, but now I think these events have given me a new language for talking about it. People want to be able to have an expectation of benevolent treatment by those in legal authority. And I think the way that actually comes out is an accumulation of not only your own experiences with someone in authority, but the stories that you hear from others with whom you have contact with. And those give you a sense of what your expectation is going to be. And so, I think that the events in Ferguson in particular, I think are one way of understanding how people were reacting to that is that, you know, that was one event too much, you know, one step too far, and an accumulation of negative incidents and bad treatment. So that's the theory. And then there's a question of, you know, how you motivate these theories. What do you do? How is it that you actually take a theory like this and say to those in legal authority that this is should be your organizing principle and not an organizing principle that's built on threat and fear, but instead is built on trust and treating people like they're citizens. Dean Magill mentioned that I, along with my colleague, Tom Tyler, and also, I don't know if you all would know, actually, I do this thing where everything in California is one place. Because, you know, I'm from the East Coast. So.
We have 33 million people in the state, right. Just, you know, FYI.
So Phil Goff, who is runs the Center for Policing Equity at UCLA, which I know is not Stanford, but it's in California. He's working on this project with me and some folks at John Jay University. We have this national initiative for building trust and confidence where we will be testing out some approaches to doing this important work to actually address distrust in their ways of thinking about police training. There are ways of thinking about different strategies. There are ways of thinking about, you know, reorganizing police agencies, which I'm happy to talk about in greater depth. I think that's too granular for this moment. But I will say, echoing what David just said about, you know, things are different, even though it does feel a little bit like 1968, if I could even say, what does it even mean for us to say that it feels like 1968? I read about it. one thing that's very different is that we have, the federal government is very committed to this idea of changing this landscape. So I think the national initiative is an indication of that. And the fact that someone like Ron Davis is the head of COPS office is an indication of that. And there is leadership in all of the relevant parts of the Department of Justice where I think we are poised to make a difference. And the leaders, the police executives leading most of the major cities are innovators. And so for someone like me, who's very close to the ground and with respect to these issues, as demoralizing as these incidents are, I also feel that we are at the cusp of a moment where we can make a difference. And that is something, if not to be excited about, to be heartened.
So, good evening. Good evening. I think I'm the one non-lawyer on the panel. So, it is good to be back at Stanford. I've had opportunity to be home for the last couple weeks for vacation, so it's very nice to be here. You know, when I was thinking about what to talk about tonight, part of it just kind of shifted based on what my colleagues just talked about. But something just came to me, I was sitting here. My phone is starting to buzz a little bit, and I'm wondering who's texting me or emailing me and what's ahead. And it just dawned on me, and I think it's relevant here, is that my 17-year-old son today at 3 o'clock was taking his driving lessons, not his lessons, his test. So I'm hoping to get a text from him that says he did well, because you know, he's stressed about it and he's been practicing. And that's relevant because as I look at my 17-year-old son, who obviously would be a young man of color, he's now, I'm assuming, going to be passed, and he's going to be driving. He thanks our car. We'll see how that goes. It brings to me a lot of issues, a lot of challenges, a lot of excitement, but a lot of concern. And so on one hand, as I mentioned to you before, I spent 28 years in law enforcement, 20 years in the great city of Oakland, a very diverse and rich city that faces challenges, and 8 years as the chief in East Palo Alto, an equally great and diverse city with challenges. And so I'm biased about police. I think there is no greater or noble profession than someone willing to sacrifice themselves, their risk, their lives, their health for other people. I say that at the same time now as a father whose son is going to be driving by himself, I still have to be concerned of my 17-year-old son, a young man of color, of what his encounter will look like. And I'm not going to apologize for that concern, nor am I going to minimize it. I try to identify why it exists. So as I look at where we're at right now, I became a cop in 1985. And I think about where policing was at that time. And if you remember, it's right about the 80s, maybe going into the 90s, for those who were around at that time, obviously not the students here. That was the beginning, I believe that was the beginning of the crack epidemic. And we were really, I would say, pretty deep into the war on drugs. And so I think about our strategies, our tactics, what we were trained to do, what we were asked to do, the methods of which we enforced the law. And it was really about enforcement. I think in the units that I worked in Oakland at the time, we put thousands of young men in jail for sales and for use and for many other things. But I think the evidence is crystal clear that that had a devastating effect on most of our communities of color, as far as the disparate incarceration rate of young men of color. But if I think now to where when I'm my time in East Palo Alto, where we started engaging in more progressive ideas of reentry, ceasefire, providing alternatives, then I agree with the panelists that in many ways we have advanced probably more so than many other professions. But as I think about my son who's going to be driving, I also have to acknowledge, and we should acknowledge, that we have a lot of work to do. So when I think about lessons learned right now, I think the biggest challenge we face, I think I'm going to take the position of more focusing on moving forward than I try to identify what went wrong, is one is it's we're not listening to each other. And what's interesting to me is because we have these divergent views with regards to police and race. And in many ways, I think the historic presidency of our current president, Barack Obama, has really underscored, I think the president has said this himself, about how much advanced a society we are. But I think some people also look into that means that there's no longer any issues within race. You could have a black mayor, a black attorney general, a black police chief, and therefore race is gone. And I think that would be really missing a larger point. And so as we start moving forward, I think one of the recommendations I would give to communities, to law students, to academics, to the police departments, is to really start listening to what people are saying to you. I think of a principle, this basic Covey principle his seven habits of effective leaders. And one is seek to understand, then to be understood. And too often we're trying to make people understand our positions before we understand what they're telling us. And so following some of these tragedies that have occurred around the country, I've had the opportunity to go to locations from Ferguson to St. Louis and to others to work with police departments, to talk to community leaders. And it's interesting to me is when you go to some of these communities, how people would come up to me, people primarily not of color, that were shocked that there was a racial issue there and thought that this incident, this tragedy somehow sparked a new racial strife that didn't exist, and really missed a larger point that it, I think the professor mentioned, it obviously has existed for a long time, but we've ignored it. We've kind of abandoned it. We've kind of pretended like it doesn't exist because there has been so much progress. And so as a former police chief that has to balance this idea of public safety, civil rights, constitutional policing, I think that is the greatest challenge that we need to face in this next 10 or 20 years. It's how do we come up with this balance so that we can continue to get the crime reduction, we can continue to have the public safety that our communities deserve, but do so in a manner that does not have the kind of collateral damage of disparate outcomes or arrest. And I think there's a couple of things we need to do. One, we need to acknowledge that there is a mistrust between many communities and the police. And we have to do so in a manner that is not indicting individual police officers as much as acknowledging that reform is needed in our policing system. To acknowledge the need for police reform is not an indictment on the police. And as a former cop, I think we need to make that clear to police officers that we will always support them and that we recognize the tough job that they do, but that does not minimize the concerns you have with regards to policing in this country or policing in communities of color. And there has to be a mutual understanding. We need to make sure that our discussions, our debates, our reform work is not targeting police, and so that they're not the target of reform, they should be a part of reform, that they're stakeholders like any other group or profession or members of the community. Sir Robert Peel had 9 principles of policing, and one of them is that the police are the public and the public are the police. In that sense, this constant divide, police and the community, us versus them, is very counterproductive to where we need to go. In many ways, and if I think back as a police chief, is we're policing in many ways, even though people are complaining about it now, we're policing the way some communities have asked us to police, even the very communities that are getting the disparate outcomes of the policing strategies themselves. So when we start talking about reform, we start looking at the work that the president's task force will do, a part of it has to be how we reform policing, how we build systems that bring trust and accountability for both the police and the community. so that everyone is a stakeholder on how we advance public safety. The other thing I would really hit home that's really, I think, means the most to me is when we talk about public safety, what are we talking about? It seems over the last 10 or 15 years, we've really have become focused on driving crime down, and understandably so. But we've gotten to ourselves much, sometimes almost to a point of being more concerned about the numbers of statistical reduction versus the idea of public safety. And so I would share with you, for me, public safety has to be more than the absence of crime. It must be the presence of justice as well. And that the ends can never justify the means during a democratic, in a democratic society. That how we get to that crime reduction has to matter. And so what's up happening is if we do not set that as communities, as elected leaders, as police chiefs, as officers, then we start making these exceptions, which means, well, I'll get back to the Constitution once the crime goes down. There's a spike in violence, so for right now, we need to do this. We need to saturate the streets and do stop and frisk. We start finding reasons why to engage in those practices we know are going to have the kind of collateral damage that destroys trust and legitimacy. So as we look at this system, I agree with my colleagues, and I also agree with them about the time. I want to hear more from you in a question than just me giving a speech. I would just say there's a couple of things that drove me as a police chief. I think about my first 6 months as a police chief. I remember coming from Oakland, going into East Palo Alto. And for those that are attending here, East Palo Alto, like I said, is a small city, but it's a very busy city, has a lot of challenges. It's a great city. And within my first 6 months, I had something like 4 officers shot at, 1 officer shot and killed in line of duty in a very short amount of time. And I remember thinking about when I got the phone call that I had a police officer that was shot and killed in the line of duty, and then found out that the person that shot and killed him was a 22-year-old gentleman who had been out of prison for less than 6 months, was on parole. And so I thought about it then is that, you know, when we start looking at tactics, is I now have a dilemma. I have a spike in crime. I have gang members that are taking over the community. I have a police officer and a family that I have to explain why this officer is dead, who killed them, and how are we going to respond. And it was interesting, is this is the greatness of East Palo Alto, is the community and I got together and we came up with a different question, not of how do we declare war on those coming out of prison, how do we recidivate them back into the prison, but the question that came up is what would cause somebody less than 6 months out of prison to be out with a gun anyway? Now, you say that there are no services available to provide that. So we went on a different journey as a department. We went to the reentry. We went finding solutions, alternatives, trying to reduce the recidivism rate through cognitive life skills and building capacity and providing alternatives. And that worked for us. It worked much better than just if I would have just ordered a sweep of the streets. So a couple of things we do know. We do know that enforcement alone is not going to reduce crime. We do know that we cannot arrest our way out of crime and violence in our communities. We know that in a democratic society, the means of crime reduction are as important as the crime reduction itself. We know that community policing demands that the community and police come together. We know that when they do come together, not only is the community safe, but officers are much safer as well. We also know that if you have strategies that engage the community, that you can sustain the crime reduction, and we don't get into the statistical ups and downs from time to time, but that we start measuring. And we know that this mass incarceration rate that the nation was involved in is expensive, ineffective, and it was disparate with regard to young men of color. And so as we move forward, hopefully a lot of the questions would be, is I'm focusing on crime reduction is because how we fight crime does go to how we have trust. Decisions we make on how we make our community safe, how people demand that they can walk down the street, how we do that matters, whether it's stop and frisk, whether it's some kind of other enforcement capacity, whether it's reentry. And we also need to talk about how what kind of expectations you are establishing and setting for your police departments. Now, in my new capacity at the cops office, it's very interesting to me, and I think the greatest challenge that I see is we give out grants to enhance community policing, but unfortunately, I still see too often people saying that during economic hardship, they can no longer afford community policing. And what I would offer to any police chief or community leader here is that during economic hardship is you need community policing more than ever. And that community policing should not be a program that has a couple officers assigned to it. Community policing was not designed to be something that you only engage in when the federal government can give you grants, but it's a general concept that when the community and police come together, identify problems, develop solutions, hold each other accountable to implement those solutions, that that's a more effective crime reduction strategy than anything else that we can do. So I agree with my colleagues. When I look at my peers before I left the profession, when I look at the progressive nature and the innovative nature of a lot of the police chiefs in this country, it brings me a lot of optimism as far as the future. But I tell you what also brings me the greatest hope about the future of policing, and I'm going to get in trouble for saying this, and I'm looking at my colleague from the Department of Justice, and he's about to probably shake his head because I'm going to say it anyway, is this generation of police officers that are coming from probably the generation that most of you are in are much, much, much better than my generation of police officers. And my generation will get mad. They're analytical. They come from more diverse environments. They're coming into the police department more educated, more balanced, more tempered. And in many cases, our systems, whether intentional or not, primarily unintentional, can actually, if we're not careful, we turn them into cynical police officers that only see the negative. When they come in full of life, full of energy, full of bright ideas, optimism, they reflect the community and the society, they reflect you inside this room. And I think we need to take advantage of the progressive leadership that's in the field, the innovative nature and the analytical nature of a new generation of police officers that are diverse, that are coming in, the knowledge that we have from the studies and research of what are the best practices to achieve crime reduction without the collateral damage, and the leadership, quite frankly, from the federal government, from the president, the attorney general, with this unwavering notion that we can have safe streets and civil liberties at the same time. And I think if we do that, then I'm really looking forward to the next 2 years really making the kind of progress that we can say that this was a critical moment. Some say we went back to the 60s and 70s, and maybe, but I would say that right here, right now is the time. You have a role to play, we have a role to play, and I would want it to look, when I look back at this 10 years from now, let this be the moment. Let this be the point in time in which we said that we had a new civil rights era, a civil rights era that wasn't against the police, that was one that was with the police in changing how we police in this country, how policing in a democratic society is supposed to go, and how we basically made this the safest country in the world, even though we have 17,000 apartments, even though we have more freedoms than any other country, that we can still have safety and enjoy those. So I think I'm overly optimistic, but I think it can be there. I think we have the capacity to do it. And I hopefully, as you start looking at your own careers, going into law or wherever you go, that you will be a part of it. You will use what you learn at this fine institution to help advance it, to help hold people accountable, to support, to defend, and to really fight for what we know is an everlasting fight in this country for the rights of everyone, even those who do not fight for themselves. So I look forward to the discussion, and thank you guys very much.
Well, why don't I open it up to the audience here. Any questions? If you have a question for a specific panelist, you can address it. Or if you have it for any member of the panel, go ahead and do the same. Leslie.
First, I want to say thank you to the law school community for having this event. I can't tell you how much students there are. My question is for you, Dean Magill, and I am sure you know it.
Well, I didn't know that was the question, but I'm glad you asked. I don't know if I have a concise answer for you. I feel like the set of conversations we're having here and in the subsequent events and in the class, in the reading group and in the class are going to help us figure out how we change the law school. We had one conversation over the break about whether we should have an additional clinic, and I'm happy to have more of those conversations. I feel like what we do as a law school is advance knowledge and train great lawyers and leaders. Those are our core missions. And so I think those are our spheres of influence as a law school, and anything that fits with those missions is something I'd want to pursue. So I'm open to suggestion. I feel like we're engaged in a conversation about the future, not just of law and the issues that are salient in law right now, but the future of what the law school does. So I'm all ears, and please make suggestions. So, yes.
I'll pick the grenade.
I was going to take it.
Go ahead.
Tracy wants the grenade.
You want the grenade?
Well, I kind of don't, but you know, it's interesting. I think an advantage of being the stranger is like I don't know you, you don't know me, we'll probably never talk again. So, you know, I get to say like I'm not even sure I understand what you mean when you say, you know, is the time for incremental reform over? So, for example, you know, would you call, you know, what some people call the, I'm not trying to be, you know, contentious, really. I can do that too, but I'm not sure what you mean. So would you say that what some people call the Warren Court Revolution was incremental? I think by definition, people who call it the revolution don't think so. Other people who are less, you know, don't think that it achieved as much would call it that. Do you think that actually living in a world in which people think that police can make a difference in crime is an incremental change? Because I think at the time when policing started to be oriented around crime reduction, which is actually fueling a lot of this, which is also the problem. I mean, as many of the panelists have said, people thought that was a huge deal. I mean, for decades, no one thought that police could do anything about crime. That was the conventional wisdom. All they could do was actually respond to criminal incidents and to have an orientation where, you know, that's taking place is totally different. So, you know, my question back to you is, could you tell me what you mean? Because I don't think I understand the question.
But like I said, it's not a subtle question. What I mean is our criminal justice system capable, as it is, of doing good? With a system of, it seems like we're so far from that. It seems like, is our police force capable of doing more good than bad? Capable of doing more than reinforcing the economic and racial order. Maybe I'm wrong about my perception of it. My sense is that there are many Americans who question that these days. And I'm wondering, our measures like continuing to diversify police force, while good, or placing cameras on police officers, are those sufficient to really change the America?
Let's try to answer the question first, okay?
And then I think the criminal justice system does enormous good every day and enormous damage every day. I think it's like most of the institutions in which we find ourselves embedded. And so I heard a couple different iterations in your question. One was, can we get to a point where the system does more good on balance than it does bad? I'm not sure we're not at that point now. I don't know how to make that calculation. I know the system does enormous damage, and there are terrible things about the system, including the way racism influences it, that we need to address. I also think, though, that in countless ways every day, people working inside of these institutions do good things. And I think that we can make these institutions do more good, and we can try to minimize the damage that they do. I think that the question of what kind of change to work for is a hard one, because I think it's an important question for any reformer about what do you want to set your sights at something that you think you can achieve, or do you want to be more wildly ambitious? And I don't think that there's an easy across the board answer with regard to criminal justice. I also agree with Tracey that it's a little hard to know what counts as just incremental. I don't think that going from all white police departments, all male police departments, uniformly reactionary police departments, to the kind of police departments we have today in most major cities was just an incremental change. To me, it changes fundamentally the nature of the institution. So I think it was huge. It's not as I can imagine more revolutionary changes, though. I think with regard to prosecutors' offices, we need something pretty big. I mean, I just think that and I don't know what it is, but I think we need to think at a pretty fundamental level about how prosecutors' offices work. But even that, I mean, you could call an incremental change. It's not overthrowing the government or, we're not going to have a new republic or something. So I think that I'm not trying to dodge the question, but I really do believe that this is... it's a deep question that you have to keep confronting, sort of in situ again and again and again. In individual arenas, you need to decide: is this something that is really worth it? And I've changed my view on something. Used to be a skeptic about community policing. I thought that it was a rebranding; it was too incremental. And I came around. I decided that. The philosophical change that community policing stood for really did make a difference. It really had effects on the way that police departments operated. So I'm now much more of a believer in it. Another dimension to your question, although you didn't put it exactly this way, but I think it's something a lot of law students think about, a lot of lawyers think about, is how important is it to change the character of the people inside of the department, and how important is it to change the institutions? Mm-hmm. I mean, I said that one of the best things you could do for policing would be just to get the bottom 20% of officers to be as good as the top 20% of officers. So that's a way of thinking about policing. Let's get better people in there. Let's make police officers better. And that, there's a point of view that says that's a fool's errand. Changing parts isn't going to do anything until you change institutions. But I feel like in this sphere, as in so many others, you need to work on both fronts and constantly readjust at what level you think you want to make your attack.
What I want to add, I think especially given the tenor of my opening remarks, that it's important to hear that to me, anyone who is engaged in the process of legal analysis and of legal activism necessarily is likely to respond to that question with an answer that says, my belief is that this matters, that the things that we're doing now actually matter, and that the alternative of seeking wholesale change is not an alternative that I'm ready to pursue. because it presents all of its own problems, some of which are, I think, far worse than this approach. And I certainly agree with the notions about what do we decide is incremental. But I also recognize where at least where I see the question coming from, because it reminds me of my daughter when we took action in one way or another, who would say to me, but is this going to make a difference? Mm-hmm. Is this going to make a difference? And so I think from that point of view, I really like the question. And I think we always need to be asking, is this going to make a difference? And if not this, then what? But I'm not ready to say that I've exhausted all the then whats such that it's time for something which is, quote, not incremental.
Yes, of course.
There's one question I think when we evaluate policing, I still think, and we should always worry about the, obviously, we recognize that the overwhelming majority of officers do a great job. And we always focus on that small percentage that cause problems. But let's, for a moment, take a hypothetical department and say that the officers did everything we trained them to do, that were free of bias, there was no racism, there were no brutality. The question would be, is would we still have disparate outcomes based on the systems we have in place, the practices that we're embracing? And I think the answer would be yes. And so I think when we start looking at reforming the system, therefore, and you ask the question about whether it's incremental, I think we're going to have to make the kind of systemic changes so that it doesn't come out with the unintended outcomes that if you're the receiving end of it as a minority community, unintended or not, it still looks and feels like discrimination. If you're the officer that's engaging it, you're saying, well, why would you call me a racist when I'm doing what the system was designed to do, you trained me to do, and I know I'm doing what I think is the right thing to do. And there is where we have this communication breakdown, and we have this, I think, challenge. And so as we move forward, as we look at incremental change, maybe it is incremental, maybe it is evolution, I would say, more than a revolution. But I think the idea would be is I think we have to focus a lot on these systems. And I think that someone mentioned everything from broken windows to stop and frisk. Is what are the systems, the practices, the strategies that we are engaging in that by their nature are going to result into these type of disparate outcomes and destruction of trust, regardless of who the officer is and how good they are? Because if we keep down this road, we're going to start getting even more and more apart where everyone feels under attack. The officers are going to feel under attack that no one understands what they go through. This is an attack. The community will feel under attack that we don't have a right to walk down the street or to protest. And I think if you listen to both sides, we're a lot closer than what most people would give us credit to be. And so the question would be, I would put in that we definitely need to really evaluate our operational systems in, I would say, the entire criminal justice system. But since we're talking about police and policing, and I think this is one of the benefits of the strategy that the president has outlined, whether it is the community policing initiative, whether it's the task force, whether it's the attorney general's smart on crime philosophy, the idea that we start looking at systematic reform of the criminal justice system so that we can really start reducing and minimizing the disparate outcomes of a lot of these practices that have been in place for generations, quite frankly. In many cases, your police departments look like they did in 1970. And the other thing is always kind of interesting to me is from the law point of view, I'm going to go to the medical field. There's still this from a policing point of view, this dichotomy of community's concern of who's accountable for crime. And one of the things I would challenge is that we are accountable for crime as a community, not just the police. If there is an epidemic or a pandemic, when we were talking about Ebola, no one protests in front of the hospital saying, why is this an epidemic? If crime goes up, I have 100 people in front of my PD saying, Chief, what are you going to do? And the only thing I have then is a big hammer, which means all of you look like a nail, and I'm going to start pounding because I need to respond to this people upset about crime. Until we take mutual ownership of public safety, community policing, then we won't embrace those kind of strategies. We're putting everything on police, and the criminal justice system is broader than that, and it has to be a part of the community.
Wonderful for me to see how many people in this community are really invested in these issues. Every time people ask me how school's going, I'm like, you know, there's so many people who are committed to social justice here and the criminal justice system. And it's one of the things I love about school. I think what was really disheartening for me over Christmas break was to go home to St. Louis and talk to my family members, and to hear them say that what happened in Ferguson didn't, galvanize the community as a whole to address these issues. If anything, they saw the white community of St. Louis being even more racist and seeing Ferguson as confirmation that, see black communities have these issues. And so I guess, what have you guys seen as effective, or what do you think would be effective in terms of getting stakeholders outside of communities of color on board? Because, obviously, for example, investing in community policing, people outside of the communities of color have to also agree, yes, we need to make these investments. And so, here people care about it. In New York, there are tons of demonstrations and marches and things. But I'm just wondering, when I go back home and I see people do, it's a completely different environment. Mm-hmm. I'm just wondering how you see engaging.
I may start. So I think that goes to one of the points I wanted to make about understanding people and their perspective. And I think one of the challenges we have is, and many of us, if we don't see it, can't feel it, then it doesn't exist. And so one of the lessons I learned as a chief when I was in East Palo Alto, and it was actually with my Hispanic community, not with my African American, is that silence does not equal satisfaction. And we sometimes think that because there are no protests, because no one has complained, because there's not an issue, then everything is okay. And then to find out that everything's not okay, that these issues have been simmering for years, just unabated. And then some kind of incident sparks it and becomes a powder keg that blows. And so I think for this new generation, I think you're seeing is the challenge is how do you get people that are not experiencing what we're talking about for our people of color to understand that it's real, that the perception is not just a perception, it's their reality, that people do have to have these conversations that we're talking about, that we're not necessarily trying to accuse that there's this widespread racism of policing, but these disparate outcomes, these interactions, these tragedies are creating even more and more mistrust. So I think, quite frankly, this is where you guys come in. I think it's not going to come from the police. I think we can keep saying it, we can keep showing it, we can keep doing it, but I think it's going to come from, and I say you because I'm looking at you as either current or future people in positions of authority and power to be able to help shape public policy so that the policy embraces the idea that there are disparate outcomes, that the policy and that the people in power pay attention to what people are saying and don't dismiss it. Like I said, to when I was in certain areas to hear from people that this was a shock to them, that they never knew there were two cities and that this was unreal. And these people were not lying. They were not malicious. They were not bad people. They were telling the truth. Then we know that we're not talking. We're not doing it. Recently, I think it was might have been Bill Bratton in New York. And I actually heard former President Clinton say this at a convening we had at the cops office. And he mentioned about, do we see each other? Right. The idea is that when we look at each other, do we really see each other and understand what we're feeling and what we're going through? And if we do that, then we have a better chance of getting people to share that experience. But I think that's the greatest challenge of the next generation is that we have a generation that even within communities of color that may not understand some of the concerns, even within our communities of color, that many others are facing, and that how do we get people to understand it so that they're invested in it and to realize that kind of disparate outcome affects them even if they're financially well off, even if they're not of color, and even if they never come into a negative contact with the police.
Can I just add something really quick to that? This isn't a sort of how do you make people see. It's really kind of a down point, a downer point. Sadly, but maybe there is more of a reason to be optimistic. And I think, everything that Director Davis said, but I think there, we also have to be realistic, which is that we're not going to get everybody. So, so David Sklansky says, in an ideal world, we get the bottom 20% to look like the top 20%, I think, with respect to your point. I think about it in terms of changing the landscape on obesity, where doctors will say, if you can just move the middle, if you can move the middle a few points, then we can make much greater progress. And I actually think that that, with respect to the kind of conversation that you're talking about, moving your middle might be a way that we are able to really gain some traction. Just sort of forget about the people on the tails. You're never going to get them. You know, this is like, there's so many issues that are like this. Gun control is like this, right? I already said obesity. There are a lot of things, I think, that are like that. And if you just sort of change your target and your goal, it might make you feel a little bit more optimistic about the conversations that you can have at home.
One of our students, way in the back there. If you can convince Professor Mack to stay for the quarter, it's done. But yes, we'll try.
Well, I'm hoping it's a weird accident that won't disappear. I mean, it's completely conceivable to me that there are a lot of officers in New York who are thinking, you know what, this is kind of more fun than the other way. It is bizarre that the form that the work resistance is taking is abandoning broken windows policing. But you take your gifts where you find them, I guess.
I guess I would like to see evidence to support that's really happening on a widespread level. I recognize the evidence of the what they're calling work slowdown or stoppage, but whether that really means that it's merely an abandonment of broken windows and that there's actually more of a community policing effort that's going on instead, that's fantastic, but I don't know that that's demonstrable.
Yeah, there's no evidence that there's more community policing in the way that we've talked about it, but I think the numbers are pretty clear. They're dramatic. And so they're not doing the kind of activity that was fueling desk appearance tickets and was fueling the kind of misdemeanor, the misdemeanor court strategy that my colleague Issa Kohler-Hausman has written about is in the last 2 weeks now is down by like 96% or something.
Just add one thing. It's not specific to New York, but whenever you're going to change processes, and this is just in general, then you have to look at the performance measures. You have to change that as well. So one of the questions any community should ask is, what is the measurement of effective policing? Right. So before we decide whether something someone slowed down, brought it up, there's natural things that go with tragedy. Right. People will be very apprehensive. But in measuring anything, what is the true measurement of effective policing in a democratic society? Is it the arrest? Is it the citations? Is it the reduction of crime? Is it public surveying? And I'm offering that as a question. I think some of the things that we have to answer, because how we answer that is, this is when we go back into the role that the community has with policing. That's then saying what your expectations are. So in other words, when you hear there's a series of robberies in your neighborhood, what do you want to hear from your police department that would suggest to you that they are doing what you paid them to do to make you safe? Do you want to hear how they stopped 50 guys around the area? Mm-hmm. Do you want to hear about how they either fixed the light because maybe it's an environmental issue? The lighting was bad. You want to hear about how they formed the neighborhood watch program and how you guys are having some kind of, you can connect to each other. What is it that you want to hear? In many cases, the answer to that will tell you what your police department is likely to be engaged in. And so when we start talking about stops and numbers, a lot of that comes down to, what are the performance measures? And in many cases, when you talk to rank and file officers, this is where their confusion comes in. What is it that you're asking me to do? How are you going to measure that? And how do I bring value to my own professional career? How do I advance inside of the police department? Is it because I make a lot of stops or make a lot of arrests? I solve problems. I engage the community. You said it. I'm going to follow it for the most part. And we're talking about the officers that are trying to do a great job. That's why I keep going back to, the solutions are going to be in those systems. They're going to be in the community systems as well as expectations, priorities, performance measures. What is it that we expect for our officers to do? What do we want them to do? And if we are then concerned when they actually do it, then what message are we telling the officers? And so I don't know what's going to happen in New York. I can't speak to that. But I would just say, in any agency that's going in reform, these are the questions they have to ask, is what are the expectations?
Gentleman in the back row, you've had your hand up.
Let's start out as a former chief, if I can. I think you're 100% right. And if you talk to many, especially minority communities, they may even tell you that officers of color they have equal challenges and concerns about the officers of color as well. As a chief, I would tell you that the individual race or gender of an officer does not make him or her a better officer. But the diversity of organization does make for a better organization. When I'm sitting inside of a command room and we're making decisions, going back to those systems, and those policies and practices, having diverse perspectives, having people bring to the table their life experiences, because I may not have been grown up in a very disadvantaged neighborhood. I may not have been stopped. I can't understand that. So somewhere at the table should be someone that can understand and bring that life experience means we make better decisions. I don't think by its nature, by itself, just hiring a diverse department is a great step. But if you still have the same systems and practices, the lack of accountability, transparency, you're still going to have problems. But if you have a diverse organizations where those diverse views are respected, that they're valued. One of the biggest things that used to come up when I was a cop, as a rank and files that we had a saying is that, you know, you that we're all blue, that you're a cop that happens to be black. And I used to always have to correct my colleagues and peers and go, you know, how do you happen to be black? I think I would rephrase that and say I'm actually a black man who happens to be a cop, which means at some point I'll stop being a cop, but I'm not going to stop being a black man. And so the idea would be is I bring that as not as an inhibitor to my job, but as a strength. I bring that perspective to the table and that I can factor that in when making decisions along with, I would say, when I have a gender diversity, especially with policing. We need more and more women in policing, and there's a whole bunch of studies that show how if use of forces go down, departments are better. But I agree with you. This doing it by itself is a good start, but it won't do it by itself.
Can I just add to that, though? I mean, of course, like you're focusing on a particular paper, which is the relationship between diverse police forces and the extent to which there are police killings of civilians, which is, of course, an important measure. But if you notice, Director Davis was also talking about the experience of the officers in the organization, which is also going to affect the ways in which they're interacting with the public. You know, I don't think Director Davis would say this, but, you know, I'm looking at Silas.
she said it, I mean it.
But I think it's hard to imagine a community, at least in the communities that I've researched, in urban communities, where it made no difference at all to the residents of communities of high crime, high poverty, and disproportionate minorities in terms of demographics, that the police chief wasn't a person of color, right? And that could be true even when the diversity of the police force doesn't affect the number of police killings. So I guess, you know, the challenge is that's an important metric for thinking about things, but I'm not sure why that's the one we should focus on. I understand why you're focusing on it now, given, you know, the impetus for this this session. But I think we have to take a broader look at the kinds of things we are assessing when we try to make decisions about what counts.
I think that skepticism about the importance of diversifying police departments has done a lot of damage. I think what happened was there are always people who are opposed to affirmative action. We started losing ground in diversifying police departments in part because there was opposition to affirmative action on the right, and the left began just not to care about this issue so much. And I just think it's a mistake. It is true, diversifying a police department doesn't solve all its problems. Nothing solves all its problems. And it's hard for me to think of anything that's happened in police departments over the last half century that's done as much good as diversifying departments has. So, I think precisely for the reasons that Ron and Tracey have pointed out, it's an incredibly important thing to pursue. Does it solve? No, it doesn't solve everything. And that shouldn't be the only thing. You know, that's not the only thing we should be working for. But the fact that it's not a panacea doesn't mean that it's not incredibly important.
Yes.
Well, one of the things that this panel should have addressed: what are the things, the underlying issues, rather than the police, which is sort of a small cog in the wheel. What about the privatized prison system? What about the inequity of the criminal system? Why do we have people, mostly of color, going away for drug crimes for 25 years when the secretary to Madoff got 6 years for stealing $6 billion? You know, so the whole equity of the system, and whether it's the police. There are more police now who have very good civil service jobs with lots of benefits, health, pensions, union protection, and they're militarized now, so it's not really an issue. And what are they supposed to be doing when they say there's no money for Head Start programs, jobs for people, and people don't have jobs and there's no social service programs? Of course they're going to do. why are we so surprised? So, I mean, unless they get lucky to get into the police department or go off to war. Going to, you know, to Afghanistan is a good job. There's lots of benefits and you risk STDs, you know. So, I mean, so what are the big issues that you should be talking about rather than the police department? Because they just get a job and they have to give tickets. What are they doing? There's nothing that they can do but to make themselves worthwhile or support themselves giving out tickets. But what is the crime? What, why don't we talk about it? This is something the law school can do. We have a Congress and Senate that's the most conservative ever, and it's so scary. You know nothing is going to change. They're all Christian and have values that will not change anything.
Their values aren't Christian.
Thank you for your comments. Thanks for your comments.
Controlling that, and what are we going to do to oversight the political system?
Well, thanks for your comments. I think there are lots of issues to discuss about race and policing, and obviously lots of other issues too. But we want to try to unpack the race and policing issues that we have a lot of accumulated expertise here today to address. So thank you for your comments. Yes?
Was forced to take
incremental steps to increase the number of police that are living in the city. How do you view that? Do you see that as effective? And what would be the way around and have people from high crime cities actually working in the city that's a financial institution?
So you looked at me and this is I gotta find a way to address this. Let me before we do that. So
the question is about police living
in the city.
So here's
what I would say before, as the police chief, that I put little focus on that, and I would turn to this institution right here. When you basically are looking for your attorney, I don't think you say, "Let me see your driver's license to see where you live." When you go to Children's Hospital, one of the best hospitals in the Bay Area for kids, you could probably care less where your doctor resides. What you're looking for is a professional that's committed, educated, competent, and sincere. As a police chief, when I went to search for my officers, I would search high and low, within my community, outside my community, across the country, to find the best and the brightest to come in. And I think what they do while they're in the community means much more to me whether or not they actually sleep in the community. And so I understand why communities want that, because the concept would be if you lived here, you would appreciate it, you would care more. And so there's a lot of programs over the years that have tried to incentivize people living in the community, but because I think there's already been constitutional law about you can't make people live in the community, then the question is, how do you incentivize it? The question is, how do you recruit from the community, right? So that, I think that's the police chief. I put a lot of focus on grow your own, getting to kids when they're younger, getting to interested about it, going to the local universities and colleges and recruiting local youth so that you have people from there. But I think if absent that, if you are really trying to get good people that care about a community, sometimes depending on the size of the community, if they all end up coming from the community, you limit your look, and you may lose just an outstanding cop who may live in a neighboring jurisdiction, kids are in school and they can't move, and so they turn you down and they could have done great things. So I think I understand why you would want that. I think the principles that make the communities ask for that are something that you can take out of the actual idea of requiring they live there and use that for incentivizing recruitment and training officers. But as a chief, I think I would stick more into focus of making sure the quality of the officers that I bring in are top notch than where they live.
I'm kind of with Ron on this, it's not where I started, because where I started was there's a long history of residency requirements for precisely the reason you identify, and they seem to me to make sense. They're very much in keeping with the idea that Ron talked about earlier, that the police are the community and the community is the police, and I'm all for recognizing that the police should be part of the community. So I like the idea. But I have found over years that when I talk to police officers, including police officers that I respect enormously,
they all say what Ron says. And I've talked to, I've talked to a lot of cops in Oakland. Some of the officers I respect most in Oakland. These are officers, you know, who sweat blood for Oakland. Many of them grew up in Oakland. They care deeply about them. They're exactly what you want. And they say they really react strongly negatively against the idea of residency requirements. Some of them say, no, I grew up here. I care about this community. It's not where I live. And I don't think I should have to live here in order to work to better the community. And because I feel pretty strongly that police reform should be a joint project between the police and outsiders, this is one on which I wind up thinking, okay, the officers themselves, including the officers I really respect, say this is a no-go. It's not something that they think makes sense. So I kind of wound up thinking, all right, let's put our energies elsewhere, which is pretty much what Ron is suggesting.
I want to pile on with just two more quick stories. One is Chicago does have a residency requirement, and what that has resulted in is this enclave of police officers near O'Hare. So, you know, that's where they live. They have their own sort of borough. And, you know, they work all over the city. So, you know, to say that they're invested in the city in the way that I think you want them to be, probably, you know, I think the proof is right there. No. But, you know, there are particular kinds of incentive programs that are very successful. So my other story is in New Haven. There is a program by which police officers get to live in public housing for free, and it's set up as a competition so that the people who are the most invested and the best and the brightest are the ones who get, you know, free lodging. And it's not only, you know, good for them, you know, the officers who end up living there because they, you know, they get to live rent-free in apartments that have been you know, refurbished for them, but it also inures to the benefit of the people who are living in public housing. So I think those kinds of programs actually achieve what you're looking for, and it's not a residency requirement.
I know there are a lot of hands. I'd love to hear from some of our students. Yes. Are you one of our students? Go ahead. Yes. That's your Stanford students. Sure.
So most agencies, I'll just speak now more as a former police chief, has a disciplinary process that you can hold individual officers accountable. I would tell you, though, to the bigger challenge for when I was a police chief is not the racist officer, because he or she will display that behavior in many venues. To think that it would only show up in car stops, it won't. It'll show up on how they interact with their peers in a locker room, comments they say, a roll call, it shows up a lot of places. And the disciplinary process was designed to hold them accountable and remove them from that service. The greatest challenge with discipline is when you talk about people that have implicit bias and are not even aware of it. Which is pretty much everyone in the room, myself included. So that's where you get to the challenge, because discipline won't fix that. It's going to be that awareness and training. So most places have strong disciplinary systems that if an officer is engaged in misconduct, they should be held accountable. Challenges gets into whether or not there's civilian oversight of that disciplinary process, to what extent there's arbitration, whether it's binding, the role of the union. So there's a lot of nuances depending on what agency, what part of the country. But just my opinion, not to read into your question, is I don't think there's been, and in many cases, civilian oversight should actually, quite frankly, turn out to be in many cases nicer with discipline than a chief can be.
Yes.
Right? Because I mean, trust me, as a former chief, if we had phrases, if you lie, you die. So if I caught you lying, you were gone. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it, your history. And civil service is more likely to say, well, it wasn't a big lie, right? Where from our perspective, it was still a lie. But I think the real question would be is, how do you come up with those systems that support the other 98% that may have those that are suffering from implicit bias and that comes out? But most places have pretty strong discipline process. I don't know if you agree with that, dude.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
For everyone, I went to the community meeting between South LA and LAPD after the dealing with Michael Brown, and there's a lot of anger, a lot of sadness. But what I sensed the most was this frustration with the lack of transparency. And I understand that with these ongoing investigations, information can't be released to the families, to the community members. But the other thing that I noticed is that people in the audience were raising their hands and asking, why hasn't the complaint I filed like last year, why hasn't there been a follow-up on this complaint of police brutality or harassment? And I looked into it a little bit, and it seems as though either there's a backlog or the prosecutors aren't taking these cases. There's an issue where the community feels that when they complain to the police departments, not much is being done. And when I was working at the ACLU, I got calls complaining about reports to WASH commanders. Nothing was happening after that. Or, you know, they feared that the police would, you know, harass them more if they complained. And the ACLU is a third-party monitor for the Los Angeles jails for the Deputy on Inmate Violence. And I was just wondering how realistic or how desirable would it be to have some separate third-party body who is in charge of possibly, you know, prosecuting or investigating these complaints by community members, so the community feels like, you know, it's not them against this sort of monolith, and they have this other sort of avenue for exploring why they might be feeling mistreated.
I'll just start and go, and I'll probably go to David, who's probably done more research on the discipline. So, I mean, I think that discussion of how civilian oversight is a local discussion that the community should work out with this police department, but I would tell you, whatever system is in place, the thing that you're bringing up are the problems that could cause the most mistrust in the process, and that is officers that are not accepting complaints, talking them way out of the complaints, not following up. In California, there's an actual timeline in which if a case is not investigated and discipline handed out, that the case will be dismissed by law. There's also state law that provides certain rights that officers have. We call the Police Officer Bill of Rights. But those, you still can work within those rights and still have a very fair disciplinary process. When you start getting into where people feel that their complaints are not being taken serious, then you have a couple of things. Either the system's not very strong or people are not complying with their own established system, right? And that would be the question then, as you know, from the ACLU, is to look at, are you following your own process and procedures and guidance and laws? With regards to the third party, I mean, one thing I thought got near you kind of mixed, conflated issues of kind of complaints and also look like would be more criminal investigation of officers. And I think that gets into the issue of prosecutors and grand juries if you're talking about shootings and things of that nature.
So there are lots of different models about how to channel citizen complaints. San Francisco, I think, has what you're suggesting. That is to say that the complaints go initially to the Civilian Oversight Board. And I think people in San Francisco, by and large, like that system. L.A., I think, has a version of that because, I, unless I'm mistaken, people can file complaints of police misconduct with the inspector general. I know L.A., and one of the reasons why the inspector general has that jurisdiction in Los Angeles is that this problem that you're discussing is a decades-old problem in Los Angeles, as in many other cities.
Not being a social media expert, but liking the question, I'll respond because I think it also makes me think about the earlier question in terms of how do we make this something that's not simply an issue for people of color or communities of color. I think that's really the great promise that social media holds in this kind of issue at this point in time, is to be able to identify ways of spreading a message. Because really, when I was thinking of an earlier answer, it's like what you need are emissaries. You need people who the broader community can accept and trust and understand to bring the issue to the broader community. And that's what social media can do. So I think that it is already having that role in making this moment a more sustained moment than it would have otherwise been. But I think that you go further than that by essentially like the citizen journalist movements, by literally creating content that can help to translate the ideas to the broader community.
I have one more for police. A lot of chiefs nowadays are also looking at it as a very positive way of engaging the community. And so instead of waiting for, candidly, waiting for the local media to write the story or tell the story, you tell your own story. And so if you want to get to now this transparency, you have more and more police departments that have Twitter accounts and Facebook. They're putting out tweets. They're putting out information. You even have police departments going around the country now that are posting every officer-involved shooting that occurs, you know, taking obviously redacting that stuff, which is required by law, so they can put as much information out there as soon as they can, the information for a community to make independent decisions, not shaped by someone else. So I think this may be one of those tools that I would recommend for the field, and I know it will be one that the task force will be looking into, of how do you use that to build trust, not so much how do you use it to be afraid of it. And more departments are really starting to see that, you know, this is a very good way of communicating with a whole new generation of young people, young adults, that may not get their news in the traditional way, but also can start a relationship and share information.
Yes.
So
whatever's happening, race is operating, yeah. And we're not racist, or we don't need to be racist, or misunderstanding, whatever it is, something is happening, and we need to bring that conversation to the forefront, but I'm just not sure how.
So, Professor Eberhard, I don't know if you noticed that the collective wisdom of the panel is that we should ask you to consider participating in the answer to this question, perhaps. Okay. Just answering this question, would you be willing? This is Professor Eberhard of the Psychology Department, a friend of the law school, and a leading researcher and expert on the topic that has just been raised of implicit bias in police forces. Would you be willing to join us?
Yeah. There are massive law enforcement agencies around the country now who are, taking their officers through racial workshops on racial bias or training around racial bias, and so they're bringing the social science data and evidence on this right to the agency. But I think that's a good thing, and I think awareness is a good thing, but just to piggyback on what Director Davis said, is that alone is not enough. Like, the awareness is not enough, because you don't know, you can have this enlightenment about how race might work and how it can affect you in ways that are beyond your awareness even. But to take that and to try to translate that into training is difficult for people. And I think it's even difficult sometimes for the researchers to figure out, like, you know, how is the lesson that we're giving about how race operates, how can people take that and make it actionable and to actually have it affect their interactions in a different way with the public. And so I think that's the hard part. And that gets, again, to what Director Davis was saying, that you need to have policies and develop structures so that bias is less, has less of an impact. So you're, I don't know that you can get rid of bias without getting rid of the disparities that we're seeing all around us, but you can create situations where bias is less likely to have an impact on your behavior.
Can I add one thing just to tell you how important this, the question you asked is one of the, I think, one of the, just a critical question, because it goes to when you're talking to officers, and let's put it this way, any of us, no one wants to be accused of being a racist when they know in their heart and soul they're not. And what sometimes you can get officers to understand is that you may be talking about race, not racism. And with race comes the issue of implicit bias and the things that the professor's talking about. That's a discussion that we're now having all over this country. So my office, for example, is funding fair and impartial policing training agencies. When we just did one in November in Ferguson, where we provided that training for Ferguson, St. Louis County, the Highway Patrol for Missouri. We are doing it in Baltimore, Seattle, all over the country, that people are, officers are learning more and more about this idea of implicit bias and how that even though they're good people, like any other people, including people of color, that that implicit bias can result into disparate outcomes, that if you're receiving it, feels like discrimination to you. And it basically is going to have the effect if as it was. And that's a discussion that we're starting to see around a country that officers are having, and they're enjoying the conversation because it doesn't feel like you're targeting them, accusing them, and we're getting a lot of feedback. I never thought of it that way. I understand what you're saying, but I agree with the professor. So now that you have the awareness, now there has to be the kind of concrete action in behaviors and systems and training and practices to help them do what they want to do in their own heart. But I think your question is 100% right, is how do you bring that to the table so that the officer knows it? And in many cases, that the same training and the training we do around the country, and just to give you an example of how lucky we are that we have Professor Eberhardt here, is I'll go ahead and get ahead of my communications director, but Professor Eberhardt will be presenting one of the first panels in front of the President's Task Force about this very issue, because it means that much to where we're going with regards to the focus on the future. But it's just something that I think it really is that critical, that if your officers can understand that, can have a dialogue about that, that's a pretty significant advancement.
And are
you seeing buy-in so far? Do they? Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, because it's what you're saying then is you're talking to human beings saying, look, you're a normal person. You're a human being, and you have biases just like I do, just like a doctor does, an attorney. And I was also going to get to sometimes the community that called you. So when the community calls you and saying there's two black guys standing on the corner, they're selling drugs, that may be a bias all by itself. Now you're getting pulled into that bias because now you're effectuating the stop that then becomes part of the disparate. So this is, most classes we do, community members are a part of it. And so I think when people realize now that you're talking about a human condition, then to acknowledge that makes me human. To say, if you say that you're a racist or that you're racial profiling without defining what that means, then for me to acknowledge that you feel that way is almost an admission of guilt that I'm a racist. And not too many people are going to do that, especially if they know in their own heart that they're not. Now, like I said, with any profession, there's a couple knuckleheads that don't need to be here, and we should always try to remove them. But the vast majority, the large group that are trying to do the right thing, this has really been effective, and there's really a lot of buy-in so far. Well, it's when the chief that asks us to do it, yes. And so it's not mandatory by any law right now. Some states have laws that mandate some kind of racial profiling training. My office has a process called collaborative reform, where we will go into it with the police department and provide an evaluation, assessment, technical assistance. We will help them. I mean, literally put teams of experts on the field to help them reform the organization. Now, one of the requisites for me is if you want this collaborative reform, in many cases, these are agencies in crisis that may be looking at, if they don't fix it, they could be looking at legal interventions or civil litigation or consent decrees. But there's two mandates that come with me. That is, one, you have to get the fair and impartial policing training. And two, you have to get, maybe if not Tracey herself, but most of the research that she's done on understanding police legitimacy and how to build trust. Because if you don't understand those two basic concepts, then it's hard to build anything from that, in my opinion.
We have more questions, but no more time. Please join me in thanking our panelists.